Thank you, Mr. Dubey, for joining us. Mr. Rajiv Dubey is the head of media for Dabur.
Thank you.
Exchange for Media Group, in association with Dainik Bhaskar Group, is curating a series of webinars, and the topic is Non-Metros Leading the Economic Resurgence, where we focus on how the Tier 2 and Tier 3 cities in India are likely to lead the recovery from the pandemic, as they have already started doing. So in this context, I have a few questions. My first question to you is, tell me what have been the key learnings for Dabur if we look at the last 6 months?
So I'll start with the key learnings in the last 6 months. So I think the biggest learning for us has been that the kind of diverse portfolio Dabur has been of a great help in this time, because this kind of portfolio helps you. I mean, there's some categories which grow, some categories which don't grow in this kind of a scenario. So that has been of great learning for us. What has been also of great learning is that India is not one market. No, India is not one homogeneous market. There's a market which is a metro market, there's a non-metro market, there is a rural market. And so it's a mix of various markets, is a mix of Dabur, is a mix of various products. So this has been a learning. And so as we go on into the conversation, I'll tell you how it's been different for us and how it's been different for the industry as such.
Right.
Because the lockdown has been very severe in the first quarter, even the second quarter has been pretty bad.
Right.
Being into a different mix of products has been of a difference to us, So that's the biggest learning for us.
Right. So tell me also, the way consumers have behaved in the consumption trends we have seen are also very different. So tell me about your observations, what kind of consumer behavior changes have taken place, especially in the FMCG category?
I think one key change one has seen in FMCG categories that, the non-discretionary products, they have suffered. They have been differently consumed. The discretionary products have been very different in terms of consumption. Like, for example, if I were to give you example of, say, hair colors, for example, or say beauty products, they would have seen a very different kind of traction in the market vis-a-vis, say, health products, vis-a-vis products which are food products or staples,
Right.
These products have seen much better times than the products which are very, very discretionary in nature.
Right. So certain kind of product categories which were earlier not as much selling, they have been selling in a bigger way. That's what you mean to say. Great. So tell me, Dabur has a 136-year-old herbal and Ayurvedic heritage. How has the brand leveraged this heritage during the pandemic when the focus has shifted to health and hygiene?
So, the health care products, the health related products, the immunity products and the health products, they have been on the center stage. And these products have been in demand, and they have definitely done much better than the other categories, because the demand for the health and hygiene, the demand for health products has been phenomenal. There's been a huge demand for these products, and that's been the priority for people also. Apart from consuming food and food products and doing the basic needs, after taking care of the basic needs, health has been the primary importance. Hygiene has been primary importance. So these products, again, have been.
Right. Every competitor is now bringing in a bit of Ayurveda in it, actually. Right. I think that's correct. Right.
Yeah. So there's a huge tailwind for Ayurveda, led by the government. Also, government has made some announcements that that people should consume kadha, for example, or people should consume, say, products like Chyawanprash, for example. So, government advisory has come from the Ministry of Ayush. So, that also has helped companies to leverage on this part. So, that's why you see a lot of companies coming up with products which are in this field, and you know, trying to use Ayurveda and trying to encash on Ayurveda.
Right.
The fact remains that Dabur has been the biggest Ayurveda company, and we are the leaders in Ayurveda, and that remains. But other companies are just trying to get into this field and try to, you know, leverage this opportunity.
Right. Reports have indicated that non-metro markets are seeing an upsurge in demand for which is higher than metro markets. Has the sentiment been the same for Dabur on ground as well?
So absolutely. So you know, if you look at the data, the first quarter of the year, which is say April to June, the degrowth which one saw was much higher for the metros as compared to the non-metros. You know, similarly, in the second quarter also there has been a degrowth, but the non-metros have been largely remain lesser affected. I wouldn't say unaffected, but lesser affected. Because, you know, when the lockdown was put into force, the lockdown was very severe in metro markets. Thereafter, I think severity of lockdown was lesser in tier two towns and was very, very less in, say, rural areas, in that order.
Right.
So that has reflected in sales also. That has reflected in the sales of products in metros and then tier two towns and then rural areas, and that trend continues. You know, that trend continues. The consumption of products has been much higher in these markets as compared to the metro markets, and that's likely to continue as the markets open up in metros. I think things will ease out. It's opened a lot now, but still, you know, there are a lot of restrictions. For example, schools are shut. The restaurants are not open fully. So these things also drive growth in metro markets to a large extent. Right. So that's right. Affected metros much more than non-metros.
Right. So I just want to just probe it a little bit more. So when we say the triggers for higher demand in non-metro markets, when we talk about it, is it also because there were lesser cases of, you know, COVID and like, you know, they didn't really get affected the way metro people got affected, you know? Was that one of the triggers, or what are the other triggers you have observed that led to this surge?
So you know, one is that lockdown was much more severe in metros. That's because, you know, density of population also very higher, very, very high in, say, metros and as compared to tier two towns. So there the spread was much lesser and they were much more open than metros. And rural areas where the spread of COVID is much, much lesser.
Right.
So that is straight away reflected into opening of the markets, opening of shops, and hence the demand and the consumption.
Right.
And one more thing one has observed is that the job losses or say fear of job losses has been much more than metros as compared to say tier two towns or tier three towns or rural areas where people are self-dependent and, you know,
not necessarily
agriculture income, etc.
Right. You know, we've also observed that Dabur has launched more than 50 products and variants since the start of the pandemic. Tell me, how have the non-metros responded to Dabur's new offerings?
So similar trend, as I mentioned to you, that, you know, tier two towns and rural markets, they contribute to about roughly about 70% of our total business. So one is that, I don't know, our business is focused towards non-metros and rural. So those are much more open as compared to metros.
Right.
So straight away translates into a better kind of demand in these markets. Plus, our distribution strength of distribution of Dabur is very, very high in these markets. You know, as compared to, say, if you look at any other FMCG company, we would have much better distribution in these areas.
Right. You know, Dabur has also banked on innovation, distribution, enhancement, and visibility, particularly in the last 6 months. You know, any insights from non-metros that have been used to cater to consumers? I mean to say, which markets are you looking at to increase penetration and reach as you already have a very broad network, but have you figured out, you know, during the last 6 months that there are more markets that can be reached out in the interiors of India?
So you know, as I mean, you would have, our CEO has quoted many times that, you know, our rural penetration has been on the, I mean, we are focusing on rural penetration. We are reaching out to more number of villages. That was the focus last year. So that continues as we go along. So that, this is as far as the rural is concerned. Apart from that, you know, one more important chain, one more important channel, which one has seen has become very, very significant is the e-commerce channel. You know, e-commerce channel has done phenomenally well in these COVID times. And that, because, you know, people are sitting at home, they still had access to internet and people could order things from e-commerce channels. And that has, that is becoming very, very significant for our business and for other FMCGs as well. So apart from the rural penetration, which I talked about, this is very, very different channel, but again, very, very important.
Right. So coming to media, I mean, the way brands are looking at media, Dabur traditionally has been a big proponent of print media. You know, if we see, look ahead as the, you know, media returns back in full force, how do you see the role of print evolving in the, in your media mix?
So, you know, I have noticed that, you know, print, so Dabur has been a very, very big spender in print, you know, traditionally, even the last year, we were present in a big way. But as far as when the COVID happened, then what happened was that suddenly one saw a huge dip in print distribution. And this observation came from the people who are, who themselves are in print business, for example, and people who are, say, on the ground. So there was a lot of confusion with respect to, you know, what is the circulation, right circulation. So if I were to give you examples of metro cities like Delhi and Bombay, one saw that there was a huge dip in the distribution of the newspapers. When you look at your newspaper guy used to come with such a huge bundle. Now suddenly the bundle had shrunk to this much. That was the first indicator which could see, which was visible to the eye. Then, you know, when you talk to the publishers, you realize that distribution has dropped and circulation has gone down, but one did not get a correct answer from anybody. That was the kind of drop, you know. In some markets, they said, we got to know that the distribution is down by 70%. That means they know only 30% copies are getting distributed. In some markets, which are, say, led by tier 2, tier 3 towns, like markets like MP or, say, UP and Rajasthan and all that, as late as August, we got to know that, you know, circulation is up to about 80-82%. This information has been given to us by the publishers themselves, you know. So, and there were some markets, you know, where the circulation was down to a great extent, but the guys were claiming that, you know, our circulation is intact and, you know, we are 90-95%, which is very hard to believe because, you know, one could see that, you know, there's been a significant drop in circulation. Right. So this has led to a major confusion in the minds of advertisers in the sense that the newspaper industry as a body has not come together and said that, you know, this is the circulation we have. This is the real circulation. And this is the real circulation. And this is the right price for this real circulation. And hence, you as an advertiser should pay so much money for this, you know. Because if you look at our business, obviously, if you look at any business, everybody would be interested in very, very ROI-led kind of buying.
Right.
You would not look at you would not like to get only, say, a 30% circulation and pay 100% price, right? The price has to be in conjunction with the circulation.
Right.
So one did not get the correct information. Now one has seen that, you know, the, I think circulation is stabilized at least in the tier 2 towns, and one can say that, you know, circulation is back to 80%. This number 80%, I'm telling you, is what has been quoted to me by the publishers, you know. So if I were to believe 80% circulation, that should straight away translate into the correct pricing of it. So this confusion of the pricing and the circulation, you know, has not been very consistent across the markets. the newspaper industry has not been together on this. You know, they have had a conflicting kind of this thing. You know, conflicting kind of numbers coming out from them. And still, you know, I mean, this time the festive period between now and say 14th of November, when we have Diwali, next 45 days are very important, because this is a time when lots of players advertise in this period, and the real impact of what is going to happen to print will be felt after this festive period is over.
Right.
Because, you know, FMCGs traditionally we advertise all through the year. We don't take a break, or we don't start extra advertising in say festive period like that.
Right.
So my request to the print industry would be to come together, come with the right pricing, come and tell us exactly what is the circulation of your newspapers, and give us a complete picture, give us a holistic picture, which is still missing right now as far as advertisers are concerned.
Right, right. I have two more questions. Tell me, how important are non-metros in your market mix? What percentage of your sales is from non-metros? And do you see this share increasing as we move ahead?
So non-metros, traditionally for companies like us, is very, very important, you know. And as I said, that, you know, about 70% of our business would be non-metros and rural put together. Yeah. So this market has been growing faster as compared to metros. So again, this very, very important market for us, and one has very good distribution in these markets. And in this period, the COVID period, one also saw that the smaller Kirana stores were supplying products to home, even when the lockdown was there. And so suddenly the current Kirana stores have come into focus, come back into focus, you know, as compared to the modern trade. That goes for metros and non-metros both. So, you know, so all these factors leading to the non-metro markets and the rural market and the Kirana stores, small format stores. So all these lead to a better growth for a company like ours, you know, which has a deep distribution in rural areas and in non-metros.
Right. My final question is about, you know, if we look ahead, how do you see the demand in non-metros panning out, you know, in terms of trends, particularly with the upcoming festive season coming closer to it, you know, in fact, the festive and the wedding season coming closer. What would be the broad trends that would lead this demand?
So, you know, so broad trend wise, one has, as I mentioned in the beginning of the interview, that I would assume that far lesser job losses in these markets, far lesser impact of COVID in terms of spread of COVID in these markets, much more open. These markets are much more open as compared to others. The smaller format stores are doing much better. So I would see that these markets are very, very important for not only for us, for others, other companies as well. And if you look at the local newspapers in the tier 2 towns and non-metro towns, you would see that, you know, surprisingly, it's come to a great surprise to me that, you know, the advertising for the cars, for example, you know, the advertising for cars, advertising for the white goods, the advertising for even for FMCGs, one has seen a huge surge of advertising in these markets, you know.
Right.
That is primarily due to the good demand in these markets, you know, because these markets are not affected by COVID as much as say metros, I would say.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Zubair, for your time and talking to us and sharing your insights. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.